on Attorney General Paul Kihara Kariuki, who's headed to the Supreme Court to contest yesterday's Court of Appeal judgment stopping the BBI process. The AG, in a draft document obtained by Citizen TV, faults the Justice Daniel Musinga-led appellate bench that, in a majority verdict, declared the proposed constitutional amendments through popular initiative unconstitutional, null and void. Well, the AG has identified three major grounds that he hopes to anchor his appeal on before the country's apex court. Francis Gashuri has the details.
A fresh legal showdown is looming at the Supreme Court, barely a day after the Court of Appeal affirmed a five-judge High Court bench decision switching off the BBI reggae. Attorney General Paul Kihara Kariuki, who has lately come under heavy criticism after a litany of government losses in the corridors of justice, is expected to head to the apex court to challenge the appellate judge's verdict. In a draft document seen by Citizen TV, the government's principal legal advisor lists three grounds for his appeal: applicability of the basic structure doctrine, remit of constitutional amendment by popular initiative, and presidential immunity. According to the AG, the Court of Appeal judges in the majority decision overstretched their mandate, insisting that historically, the doctrine had only applied in situations where the amendment power is reserved for parliament and where people have no direct involvement through a referendum. The AG says the 2010 constitution has elaborate provisions to protect its basic structure.
We do not agree, at least for now, with the reasoning of the court that the current constitution does not provide safeguards that will not necessitate the application of the basic structure doctrine. We are of the firm view that Chapter 16 of the Constitution provides sufficient safeguards and that it is not necessary to import foreign doctrines into the country in a situation where those safeguards are sufficient.
According to the AG, the appellate judges missed the point when they listed President Uhuru Kenyatta as the promoter of the BBI-driven popular initiative to amend the constitution.
The president's conduct is different from that of ordinary citizens. In acknowledging this plain and in spirit of fact, one does not thereby curtail the president's enjoyment. One might even say deployment of his personal or political rights. All it means is that the space upon which he elected to exercise his rights is reserved for ordinary citizens, the common populace of the Republic of Kenya, and it is not open to the president. It is out of bounds to him.
The president, according to Kariuki, was not expressly barred from initiating amendments to the constitution through popular initiative, and that, like any other citizen, he enjoys civil and political rights, including rights to initiate constitutional amendments.
We are not persuaded that the president cannot initiate a constitutional process, although we also argue that in this case it wasn't really the president that initiated this process. This process was initiated by the BBI promoters, and on that we find that the court has erred, and depending on the reasoning that we see in the written judgment, it is a matter that we may take to the Supreme Court.
We would definitely still be engaged by any appeal processes that would be there because we would be served as respondents. So even if we shall not be appealing ourselves, we would definitely be parties to any appeal processes that would be there. And I am almost certain that somebody will have to take this to the Supreme Court.
On the question of presidential immunity, the AG holds that the president was insulated from prosecution during his tenure and that the judges contradicted the constitutional provisions on presidential immunity. While the Attorney General exuded confidence that the Supreme Court will overturn the Court of Appeal verdict, legal players who challenged the BBI process in the High Court and contested the appeal hold a different opinion.
You see, now you'll be having 12 individuals well schooled in the law have already made their decision on an issue, and you're taking it to another 7. I don't think the outcome will be different. And then at the Supreme Court is limited to questions of law. It doesn't look at facts, so the points are narrow. You already have 2 courts reaching the same decision. I don't think the Supreme Court would depart unless something radical happens.
Francis Gashuri, Citizen TV.